The Otto cycle is the ideal cycle for what we know today as a gasoline engine or an internal combustion engine. It's a thermodynamic cycle that uses gasoline and a spark igniter to generate thermal energy that is then used to create motion. The name of the cycle comes from Nikolaus Otto, who built a working engine in Germany in 1876. The engine consists of a piston that moves four times, usually called the strokes, within the cylinder. The piston, usually shown coming from the bottom of a vertical piston cylinder arrangement, is initially at the bottom. The top of the cylinder has an inlet and an outlet called intake and exhaust, respectively. Before the first stroke, called compression stroke, the cylinder is filled with an air-fuel mixture. During the first stage, while both openings are closed, the piston moves up, compressing the mixture and raising its pressure. At the top of the cylinder, we have a spark plug. This spark plug is an electrical device that receives high voltage electricity to produce a spark between the positive and the negative electrodes. Right before the air-fuel mixture is fully compressed, the spark plug fires, igniting the mixture. As a consequence, the piston is pushed downward. This is called the expansion or power stroke, which is the second stroke. Right before the piston reaches its initial position, the exhaust valve opens. Since what's inside the cylinder are hot and therefore higher than atmospheric pressure combustion gases, they quickly flow out of the cylinder without the piston moving much. However, right after that, the piston does push upward to purge all of the exhaust gases in the cylinder. This process is called the exhaust stroke or third stroke. After the exhaust gases leave the cylinder, the exhaust valve closes and the intake valve opens to let the air-fuel mixture come into the cylinder. As the piston moves down once again to its initial position, the fresh air-fuel mixture is pulled by the pressure being lower than atmospheric pressure. This is the fourth and last stroke. Once the air-fuel mixture is inside the cylinder, the valve closes and the cycle starts over. The ideal Otto cycle adds ideal conditions to some of these stages and even the steps between stages. The cycle takes into account the first two strokes only, and to simplify it, it assumes that the gases are air only, and that instead of the combustion and the release of gases, there's just heat being added and removed from external sources. This simplification of an open system to a closed system is very similar to what we described in the Brayton cycle 11-minute lecture, link below. First, the first stroke is assumed to be an isentropic compression process. Since the cylinder is assumed to be perfectly insulated and therefore adiabatic, and under ideal conditions the process is isothermal for it to be reversible, the compression being isentropic makes sense. Then, we can assume that the ignition of the mixture with the spark plug is just an isochoric heat addition step between stroke 1 and 2. After that, for the second stroke, and under the same assumptions of insulation and reversibility, we have an isentropic expansion process. And finally, between stroke 2 and what would be stroke 3, when the exhaust valve opens and the higher pressure makes the combustion products rush out, we describe it to be an isochoric heat rejection process. This would bring our air back to state 1. On a PV diagram, we would see the isentropic compression from 1 to 2, heat addition at constant volume from 2 to 3, the isentropic expansion from 3 to 4, and then heat rejection at constant volume from 4 to 1. On a TS diagram, we're going to see something very similar to what we see in a Brayton cycle. From 1 to 2, we have isentropic compression, which raises the pressure. From 2 to 3, isochoric heat addition, as opposed to the isobaric process in a Brayton cycle, which means a different slope here. From 3 to 4, isentropic expansion. And from 4 to 1, isochoric heat rejection, again, as opposed to isobaric in a Brayton cycle. Also, note here that the larger volume is the bottom curve, and that the smaller volume is the top curve, which is the opposite of pressure. The lowest position of the piston, which corresponds to the largest volume, is usually referred to as the bottom dead center, or BDC, and the highest position, which corresponds to the smallest volume, is usually referred to as top dead center or TDC. The compression ratio in Otto cycles refers to the ratio between the maximum volume over the minimum volume. The energy conservation equation would be that for a closed system. So pay close attention because this is the biggest difference between Brayton cycles and all of the steady flow processes or steady state devices we've been working with for the last several lectures. In steady state devices like turbines, compressors, and heat exchangers, our closed system energy conservation equation splits the work term into the system or boundary work and the flow work, which is part of the work that pushes the working fluid into and out of the steady state device. Watch the 10-minute lecture on flow work if you don't remember this, link below. This flow work or PV term is what in combination with the specific internal energy term becomes specific enthalpy. But in the Otto cycle, we don't have that PV or flow work term to make the working fluid pass through devices. The Otto cycle is just air inside a piston cylinder device. What this means, in a nutshell, is that the terms we'll find in the energy conservation equation are internal energy terms, not enthalpy. All of the work during the compression stage goes into the fluid, no flow work to push the fluid in the system, and since there's no heat transfer, it makes sense that the work changes the internal energy of the fluid. The same is true during expansion. The work produced by the fluid in this adiabatic process going from 3 to 4 is equal to its change in internal energy. And as for the heat addition and rejection processes, these happen with no work being added or removed, and also at a constant volume, which makes sense we would also use internal energy. With these, we can write the thermal efficiency of the Otto cycle. The net specific work is work out minus work in, and the specific heat in is the specific heat between 2 and 3. This would result in U3 minus U4 minus U2 minus U1 over U3 minus U2, or alternatively, all of these in terms of CV. One last reminder here before we look at an example on Otto cycles. Since we have isentropic processes with ideal gases here, we can use the relationships we derived in the 12-minute reference entropy lecture, link below. We have the relationships we derived between pressure, temperature, and volumes for ideal gases that have constant specific heats, or we can use the concept of relative volumes we explained then, and the relationship between volume ratio and relative volume ratios, and of course the tabulated values for each substance. This is what we labeled exact analysis, which we can use for ideal gases with variable specific heats. Let's look at an Otto cycle example where we use part of what we learned today, and in the additional video examples linked below, you'll find more complex examples on this topic, including a temperature ratio relationship for gases with constant specific heats. An ideal Otto cycle has a compression ratio of 9. During the constant volume heat addition process, 720 kilojoules per kilogram of heat are added to the air. What is the temperature at the end of the heat addition process if the temperature is 300 K at the beginning of the compression process? Pause here and try solving this problem yourself before watching the solution. Since we have air and we have tables for air properties, we know that we can find the temperature at any stage if we have any of the properties on that table. And if we look at our quick PV diagram, we see that we're looking for T3. In this case, the property we can find for 3 is the specific internal energy because we have the heat going in between 2 and 3. We do still need to find U2. To find U2, we're going to need one of the properties from the table. And because we know that the compression between 1 and 2 is isentropic, we can use the isentropic relationship for volumes from the exact solution. This means that we need the volume ratio, but we have that from the compression ratio, and also the relative volume at 1. But since we have the temperature at the beginning of the compression process, we have T1. We go to the table to find VR1 for T1, and we use it with the compression ratio to calculate VR2. We go to the table to find the closest two VR values, and we interpolate to find U2. With U2 and the given heat transfer, we calculate U3, and once again, with the two closest values to U3, we interpolate, this time to find temperature T3. And this is the temperature at the end of the heat addition process. For more complex problems on Otto cycles, as well as the previously mentioned relationship between temperatures for constant specific heat gases, make sure to check out the links in the video description. You will also find links to the other lectures of the Thermo course, as well as the playlists of other engineering courses. Thanks for watching!